extract, transform, load application for a lot of common survey research data processing scripts. It's very visual interface, easy to use. Not going to talk about loaded today. We're going to talk about coded because I think that impacts this group more. So coded is an automated verbatim coding tool, certainly traditional verbatim coding, but we put a lot more focus on text analytics and machine learning as ways to optimize the human's performance and to create an overall automatic system as well. So we'll talk more about that today, and Stacy will give you some real-world examples of how coded has helped RDI serve. All right, so this is our world. So I'm 38 years in, and I've been a DP all my life, and my whole X and Y axis is cost and time. I mean, research goals are great, it's always good to talk about that, but how many times do you just come down to how much money do you have? What's the budget? How much time? And so data processing techniques surround that. And so when we looked at the world of verbatim coding, we didn't go out to try to change it. What we're trying to do is bring more methods to it. So if my time is going to be impacted by things like the method, of course the cost is going to be up to the client, how specific and detailed things have to be. And in the world of coding, how many categories in the code frame, simple things like that can really impact the overall performance of the humans and machines. And then of course there's a lot of different kinds of studies. So if I have ad hoc, quick hit, never seen this before, concept test stuff, text analytics is really fast. It's really very accurate. I'll say that word accurate at giving you directional advice on where the product is, where the service is. Once we start collecting data, we have tracking studies and ongoing repeatable code frames for clients, then I can start using more of the automation, specifically the machine learning, where I can use a history of coded comments to automate the coding of new comments. But we don't turn our backs on humans, so for the very highly specific, take your time, it's going to cost some money stuff, we still have a fully traditional verbatim coding interface. It's really key to us to have an interface for the humans to interact with the system, no matter what type of method they use. And so we made a tech stack out of this, and you can use things exclusively. The humans only, you can code the text analytics only, or you can put them together. And so this is kind of a common, everyone wants to ask how I'm going to move the text analytics up to the top, but you can use the different tools in any order. What happens is you create these loops. So if humans are coding and they're training the machine learning that much more, then I can run machine learning and then have the humans come back in again and sort of each of them propel the process forward. I can use the text analytics to very quickly generate a lot of thematic phrases and technical sentiment. And I can use that. That might be an end product of research, but I can use it to train the machine learning. So now I have one machine teaching the other machine. And it's that concept of singularity that we are so fearful of in our future, but it works. And so it's really up to the user to decide which are the best methods to employ and how to employ them. That's key to us. I mean, crucially for us is that there's a human user interface to this entire thing. And it's for anyone to use, analysts, coders, DP people, end clients. We're trying to focus on DIY side of this, so that anybody can use these rather advanced techniques to get the work done and to use them in the right mix for whatever the research goals are. So that's the reality of what we do. What we're thinking about next year is we have this issue with market research. I always say, how many cookbooks do we need? We have a lot of small sample studies, a lot of clients. I've seen hundreds and hundreds, maybe thousands of code frames and studies by this point, and they're all the same. And so everybody's doing the same thing in their own little silo for their 150, N equals 150, they're getting much bigger now. And we don't playbook together. So what we're looking at in code is if a lot of people are coding, and they're designing code frames, and they're using the AI and text analytics, we have an opportunity. So we're implementing this currently in our software to open it up so that multiple, okay, if you're one agency, all the clients can be pooled together. So you can start to build machine learning libraries around the client. Or maybe it's a business sector where you have several clients. The next step is maybe across companies. We don't normally play that way together, but we're setting up the possibility where we can pool a lot of data across business segments. It's secure, no one else sees you verbatim, anything like that. It's just an algorithm that you can use to pull down from the library and code like studies within the same business segment. So, the word consortium comes up, we call it metacode internally, but that's what we're trying to look forward to as a more of a disruptive idea within our industry, where you might actually be helping each other. At least within coding tasks. So our experience thus far is there is no silver bullet. I think we've all understood that. You have to use a blended approach. So I'm going to use humans, I'm going to use text analytics, very fast techniques, and I'm going to use machine learning, which allows me to sort of, it's like a vintage, you age your work over time and extend that learning so that you can code more and more things, very much mimicking human coding. The good news is that, it's a mistake to replace humans. A lot of times when I go to sell the software, coders think I'm trying to take their jobs. It's quite the opposite. Their jobs are changing, and I want to change with them. They're data analysts now. They're not necessarily just straight programming coding. So we think that they're a critical central piece to all of this. We just have to give them the tools so that they can very quickly implement these advanced technologies. And then the last thing is 20 years ago I started messing around with machine learning and text analytics. It's old, but it's young. There's a lot more emphasis on it now. Big players are coming in. There are a lot of free DIY tools, and that's fine. It's great to look at that stuff. But at some point, to put it all together in a complete tool, that becomes difficult to maintain as a single company. So we're looking forward to working with all of you and a lot of the newer techniques to come. And so getting back to, like Kirti said, the competency of the now, I want to introduce Stacy Dye, SVP and General Manager of Quantitative Insights at RDI SIRS, and she's going to talk to you about how she uses Scrum.
Awesome. Thank you, Rudy. I appreciate it. I will be a clicker. So thanks, everybody, for sticking it out with us. I know this makes for a long couple of days just watching presentations back to back to back. So we appreciate you guys hanging in there until towards the end of the second day. As Rudy mentioned, I work for the Quantitative Insights Division for a local market research company. We provide full-service, quantitative, qualitative work, but we also do a lot of coding. We do a lot of coding for ourselves and our clients. We also do a lot of coding for large market research companies, both here in the Greater Cincinnati area and across the nation. And so, because of that, it's obviously a large portion of our revenue, and it's very important to us and our clients that we get it right. It's also important to our clients that we get it to them quickly, and we get it to them cheaply, because that's how people want things now. So how do we go about that? Traditional coding comes with a lot of costs and long timing sometimes. It takes humans, and humans are slow. So for low volume projects, if it's just, 1,000 verbatims, our humans can actually get through that pretty quickly. They can code those, get them back to a client, no big deal. For big projects, and I'm talking projects we have, 10,000 verbatims, 50,000 verbatims, 100,000 verbatims, we can't get through those very quickly. That's a really tough
gotta make sure that the coding that we're putting out there is precise. Our clients, at the end of the day, want answers, and we want to make sure we're giving them the right answers. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about one of our largest clients that also happens to be our parent company, REI, and they're also here in Cincinnati. Some of you may be familiar with them. So REI is a contact center company, and what that means, also called a BPO, or business process outsourcer, and what that means is we take inbound, outbound sales calls, we do customer service calls, we even do tech support calls for a lot of clients. And so, for instance, if you call Toro, the lawnmower company, and you can't get your lawnmower started, and you need to talk to a human being that can help you do that, you're essentially calling us. Now, if you call Gerber Life Insurance, and you want to purchase an insurance policy for your new infant, you are also calling us. We have licensed insurance agents that can do that work. So we're doing a lot of different kinds of things at a pretty big scale. So we have about 3,000 employees across the U.S., 8 locations, lots and lots of clients. So 100-plus clients at any time, 10 to 20 industries, and we handle over 50 million customer contacts every single year across multiple channels. And so what do all those clients want to do? They want to understand how those interactions are going, what's happening. So we use a lot of different tools. We use speech analytics to understand the calls themselves and what's happening in those calls. We use text analytics to understand the emails, texts, chats, those types of things. But of course, they want to hear from the person's mouth. They want to hear from the customer how that call went or how that contact went. And so we do a lot of surveys. We do IVR surveys, email surveys, text surveys. We even call people back and ask them how their interactions went with us. And we collect a lot of different measurements. You know, depending on the client, they have different things that they want to measure. But we always try to get some kind of open-ended in there because we know it's important. We know that essentially when we provide data back to them, they need more than just that measurement. You know, everybody kind of defaults to a dashboard. And in the market research world and in the contact center world, we love dashboards. We like to look at lots of pretty data. And sometimes they're useful. A lot of times they're interesting, but they don't always give us the answer. And I don't know about the rest of you, but my clients want the answer. They don't want to have to do a lot of work. And so what we find is we put dashboards in front of them, and then not a lot happens after the fact. There's not a lot of finding that answer. And so, for instance, in this case, you know, you might find out pricing is associated with dissatisfaction. Well, what does that mean? Does that mean it's, you know, the price itself? Are we not, if it's retail, are we not putting things on sale enough? Are we not couponing enough? You know, what can we really do with that? And so from the traditional market research world, this is what I was used to. And, you know, here, this is a pretty simple codebook. A lot of times, for those of you who have done this work a long time, there's sub-subnets and sub-sub-subnets, and it goes on and on and on. But the nice thing here is my client can look at this and automatically get to an answer, or at least close to an answer. So for instance, here, I've got a significant amount of detractors saying that they went straight to the survey. We didn't even help them. Wow, like, do we have a telco problem? Do we have an agent problem? What is the issue with that? I can immediately figure out I've got an issue, and here's who I need to talk to solve that. I've got some people saying that the product, they're having a hard time just getting it set up. Well, that's important. That's information that I can feed back, you know, not just internally about agents and what have you, but I can send that back to my client and say, hey, we've got some information that can help you in product development. And so that's really what we wanted to do, is be more than just a call maker and a call taker. And so we wanted to take these interactions, we wanted to survey the customers. You know, in the case of an IVR survey, we're turning that coders, so they can make them a little more efficient. But at the end of the day, our coders still have to read the comments, and if they have 10,000 comments to read, that's going to take some time, no matter, you know, what kind of tool you put in front of them, that just takes time. There were other products at the other end of the spectrum that kind of automated everything. There wasn't a lot you had to do, and you could take that automated information and you could kind of start to combine things and get to a better answer, but it really wasn't putting the answer right out there in front of us, where we were getting when we had those human coders and that traditional coding. And that's where Coded came in. For us, it gave us the perfect blend of, let's have a human start this, have them set up the code frame, start the coding, but let's not have them keep coding. Let's have machine learning that starts to figure out how it's working and start coding those responses. So they're coding a small portion of what's available, but the machine learning is doing the rest for us. And so this is, I'm hoping you can see these. These are a couple of examples from traditional market research studies of how this has helped. So in the first example, we have a drugstore tracker. We have about 50,000 responses to code. That's a lot. I guarantee you that years ago, this customer would not have had to code these responses. It would have been impossible. We estimated that if we had done this manually, it would have taken us about 500 hours to do it. It took us about just over 100 hours, 120 hours. Not too bad. For a financial tracker, we had about 7,000 responses. We estimated it would have taken us over 100 hours. It took us 40. So when you think about what that's doing for us from an operational efficiency standpoint, and ultimately for our client, is huge. So, like I said, I can't make the humans go any faster. As much as I'd like to stand behind them and crack the whip and make them code faster, it's just not possible. So we need some tools to help us get a little bit better, but still provide that detailed, accurate information.
times we did the same text, and you have multiple topics, and you are kind of uncertain which one is the dominating topic, okay? Or the main topics. There is a lot of juiciness. Well, what your tool does to deal with that, you know, multiplicity of themes, we think that.
So you have the same topic set within the sort
of. Let's say that you are in the in this business of getting a consumer company. Yeah, right? And the person is saying, you know what, I have a problem with the insurance, right? But, you know, it is super expensive and you didn't respond in time, right? So what is really the main topic here? Right?
So
in this case, you know, what type of analytical approach you suggest to do the proper coding and score the right way?
Sure. So I think what you're saying, and I'll restate it just to kind of make sure I'm grasping yours, you might have a situation, a study, a question where you're trying to figure out, you know, what kind of buckets am I looking for, and you don't really know where to start. Is that?
Yes, right? Okay. Yes, you know, there is this concept of being in duplicated type of comments and all that, but I'm trying to see if you have developed the intelligence to assign certain higher weight, if that's the really the voice to use here.
So I think you have to be willing to start reading comments. And I mean, I hate to say it, a lot of people, they don't want to do that. They want to start with kind of these buckets that they've seen and, you know, pricing is driving dissatisfaction. Well, there might be something in one of those other buckets that's maybe not even shown there that's critically important that you don't know. And so I think you do have to start reading some of them. Now, you're going to get to a point where Codit's just going to start bucketing a lot of them for you, but you've got to do some of that, or you're going to miss something, for sure.
You'll find as well, like back to the NLP side, the text NLP, you'll get a fairly granular topic analysis of each comment and the sentiment tag with it, if there is sentiment. I'm frequently asked, you know, what about all the stuff that misses? Well, it doesn't miss anything. It's very, you know, one comment will come back with many, many findings. Some will just be themes, others will be topics with sentiment and the expression used of this. It's quite granular. There's a lot of pieces you can use to make sure you get it right. You know, and if and you're right, I mean, a lot of people say similar things in slightly different ways, and it builds up really fast. It becomes difficult for consumers to sort of say something totally novel about the flavor of the product or the price. They start really saying the same things, just slightly different.
And Codit has a really cool thing, like as the coders are going through and starting to figure out, you know, what buckets they want to create, if it runs into something it hasn't seen before, it'll alert them and say, hey, this is something new. I don't know what to do with this, which is really cool because that makes sure you don't miss things.
Really, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.